With the Alpine, Chrysler undoubtedly have a very versatile, full four-door saloon, but one with the almost universal opening rear hatchback, the rear seat folding down so you have an estate car as well. And judging by the fact that the car has already won the lion's share of the Car of the Year awards, then the American owners have cause to be optimistic. As far as the mechanical specification goes, well, they've sided with the increasingly dominant front-wheel drive force. Fitted with either 1294 or 1440cc power, since its July launch, it's specifically been chasing the sort of people who've been buying Renault's R12 and 16, both sizes of Golf from VW, as well as the Leyland Allegro and Maxi customer. In addition, offering a technically more sophisticated package, the Alpine must be an attractive alternative to marina buyers, as well as some of those who've been flocking to the best-selling Escort. While the thought that even their own Avenger must suffer, though officially the Alpine is only supposed to replace the Hunter in High Time 2. The suspension at the front, inspired by the Simca 1100, and handling are of a very high order indeed. Somehow they've managed to achieve the soft ride, but with an almost complete absence of roll. You get an overhead camshaft, a cross-flow alloy cylinder head, and a twin-choke carburetor. Being a relatively large car for the engine size, fortunately both Simca motors feel and sound really eager. However, you do need to use the excellent gearbox to accelerate with any real effect. Although having said that, you can still pull away from 10 miles an hour or so in as high as third gear. According to whether you buy the smaller engine GL or the longer stroke and sportier S, with an ample 13 gallons on board, you should extract the realistic average of between 30 and 35 to the gallon. And like every manufacturer, Chrysler claim more. But if you are coming down in engine or car size, then maybe you're going to find the Alpine just a little bit noisy, particularly at high speeds. Case I'd have thought for higher gearing rather than more soundproofing. A rather rare steering wheel design here allows you full visibility to the few instruments and the row of warning lights. Quite a good idea. All the controls fall nicely to hand, though perhaps a tall driver isn't going to like the lack of support under the knees from the seat squabs. Heating and ventilating systems pretty adequate though, a row of vents here along the dashboard, and ingeniously the two centre ones can be tuned to give you fresh air face level ventilation, at the same time the outer ones demist the side windows with hot air. The bumpers are impractical off-white, although of course you can see the car very clearly. Another new car though where plastic has been used. They certainly feel pretty sturdy though. As far as the bonnet goes, mighty heavy affair it is too. Presumably that's all to do with crash engineering. But the low bonnet line is all thanks to the engine, which has been canted to the rear 41 degrees. It also means that the fuel pump, the dipstick, and the distributor, electronic incidentally, with no contact set to adjust at all, as well as the coil, they're all very accessible indeed. However, the alternator drive belt tension right the way down at the front of the engine and the oil filter right the way down at the back have to be got at from underneath. But it certainly is a very wide car indeed, especially for a car with such a small engine size. Perhaps this can best be accentuated when you look across the rear seat and you realise that three adults can sit side by side there in relative comfort. Plenty of room in the back too, although perhaps the width of the loading area is a little bit restricted thanks to the rear shock absorber mountings and the inner wheel arches. Plenty of depth to the boot, and of course they'll tell you you have the advantage that you don't have to disturb your luggage to get at the spare wheel, because that's buried away underneath here. I find a bit of a disadvantage being in a forgotten state. Full marks to this though, this luggage cover, very good idea and a good deterrent to the burglar. However, don't be fooled into thinking that this is a British car. It's not. True, once upon a time it was designed in Coventry, but here is yet another new car on sale by a British car manufacturer, and Vauxhall and Ford do this as well, that comes wholly from abroad. For the Alpine is built by Chrysler's Simca workforce in France. So if their market researches are right, Then the 28,000 Alpines that they hope to be selling in Britain this year are going to be on our imports bill. And even when it's eventually assembled at Ryton by a greatly reduced workforce, then it's going to be no more than a kit of French manufactured parts. Yet, whatever its origins and whosever economy benefits, one must say that the Alpine GL at £2,164 and the S at £200 more is still the best Chrysler product yet.